Welcome back to Series 3 in the Atari ST Nostalgia GFA Basic Tour. In the previous video, we gained some insight into memory allocation and preparations to enable us to manipulate the ST's memory much more directly. We will now use this knowledge to move graphics on screen, and this video will focus on the BMove command. So, what does the BMove command do? Well, basically, all it does is move blocks of data around. So it is not a graphics command. Remember, we need to understand that the screen memory is just a bunch of bits. And in monochrome, every pixel is one bit. It's either 1 or 0 or black or white. So that gives us, in our case, 400 bits or 80 bytes per scan line. In color, that would be 160 bytes per scan line, but we might get to that in a future video. For now, in monochrome, we have 80 bytes per scan line, sorry. And we can manipulate per byte with this command, not per bit. So it's not based on X, Y coordinates. Remember, it's just a bytes block operator. And as you can see in the syntax also, it shows. So the syntax of BMove is basically execute the command, tell him a source address, and this has to be a long word value, saying the source address in bytes, and then the destination address where I want to copy my block of data to. And I have to tell it the number of bytes that I want to copy. And you can use it for any memory operation you want. And in this case, we are concentrating on how it will be used to influence the screen contents. And just a little show and tell or practice, I created this little bit of code that basically makes a big black box. And then at the bottom, there's two smaller boxes on the left and on the right beside it. And when we look at our magnificent graphics that we created here, I am going to use the BMove command to copy the upper 25 lines of this box. So the upper 25 lines of that part of the screen to the top of the screen, which basically, and I'm using the XBIOS 2. I could also use XBIOS 3 because they are both the same in my case. I didn't change anything. But what I'm going to do is basically I'm going to tell it to look at the start address of my screen plus 8,000 bytes, which means plus 100 scan lines, which is actually also the top of my box, as you can see, the Y coordinate. And I'm going to tell it to copy that to actually the start address of the screen. And I want to copy 2,000 bytes because 2,000 divided by 80 is 25. And we should see the effect that the top part of the box is now also at the top of the screen. And the next thing I'm going to do is exactly the same. So exactly the source and destination address are the same, but I'm thinking like if 80 bytes is like the whole screen, then 40 bytes would actually be only half of the screen. So I'm going to do the number of bytes, but minus 40, just to show what actual effect that actually has. And then I'm going to do a really exciting one, which is I'm going to BMove, in this case at address 22,020. So it's at like scan line 275, I think, 275 or 276. Basically where the three boxes, all of them are at that top. But instead of the start of the screen, I'm also going to add 20 bytes to the source address, which basically means I am going to be at the position of pixel number 160 of the screen. And from there, I'm going to copy to the exact same scan line, but now at pixel position 0. And the length I'm going to copy is 1980 bytes, so not 2000, but it's like 25 lines minus these 20 bytes that I didn't take in the beginning. So the bottom should be shifted to the left. And the effect of this one, if you treat BMove as a graphics command, or think of it as a graphics command, the effect looks really weird. But it's actually completely logical, and I wanted to show it as an example of how this command actually operates. So we are going to start the program, and as you see, it nicely drew the three boxes. And it copied the top 25 lines of that box to the top of the screen, so that works. Then I copied the same 25 lines, but minus 40 bytes, also to a position slightly higher. And as you can see, the half of the lowest scan line is missing, but only that part. So don't think of BMove as a graphics command where I can take only the left side of a screen or something. It really only reads bytes from a start address and then goes through the lines one by one. And to really show that effect, the next move, which was basically the corner where the box on the left and the black box are touching, I'm going to move from that part to the left, 20 bytes to the left. And this is the effect. And if you think of BMove as a graphics command, this effect is really, really weird. But actually, if you think of BMove as really the byte operator that it is, this is actually totally logical. And I know this might be a bit difficult to comprehend, so I've created some visualizations because this behavior seems strange, but actually, I created some visualizations to explain this as best I can. Because, as you can see, I created sort of a grid of the screen where in the top left you see that it's byte 0 and byte 10, 20, 40 is halfway the screen up to byte 79, and where byte 80 is the one that actually starts at the new screen. And I created a visualization of the three boxes. The visualization is in color just to be able to determine between the three boxes a bit better. But the example is actually for monochrome, so keep that in mind. But the start byte that I was moving is like this XBIOS 2 plus something something 20, which is now represented by the red dot in the figure. And the important ones to note is also the second line of that box, the yellow box, the second line, but at the start of the screen, which is byte 80. So it's something something plus 80. That's the purple box. And the last byte to copy is actually the end of the screen, which is basically 320 bytes in this case, because it's only four scan lines, and minus 20, so that's 300. And if I do the B move, this is what happens, and this is exactly what we see in the play screen. So we see that the black box is now to the left. The box that was to the right of it is actually also shifted to the left, but now it's at the half of the screen instead of three quarters. And the box that was to the left is now to the right. And the top line is actually missing. And at the bottom, you see that the black line is actually two pixels instead of, it's like two lines instead of one. And that is the exact effect that we are seeing here. Because remember, the byte that was at 20, like at something, something 20, is now at byte position zero. So that's to the left of the screen. And this top left corner of that blue box, which was at something, something 60, is now at position 40 when you count the bytes. But it also means that the purple box, block, that was at actually byte position 80 is now at byte position 60, which means it actually removed to one scan line higher in the screen, because it's no longer on the next scan line, it's still on the same one, and it shifted 20 pixels to the left, and that's what's happening. And also you can see that the lower right corner of that blue box, which was at position 320, now is at position 300, so that has been shifted. And the blue line you see at the bottom right is actually just the line that was already there. It's not affected, because B move is called B move, but it actually makes a copy of the bytes. And this effect is exactly what we are seeing here. And it's very, very important to keep this in mind, that this is how the command works. And this is also how the shifter reads the screen and builds the screen. So you have to keep this in mind, because if you understand this, then the B move command actually becomes fairly easy to use. So in the remainder, I want to just show some examples of how you can use the bmove command. And the first thing I want to do is, I've written a little bit of code, which basically what I do is I pre-draw a bunch of screens, and then I move that data to two different screens. So I create a canvas on my buffer screen, and then I create a bunch of circles on my screen. And in both cases, from my buffer screen to some allocated data and memory, which now I've labeled screen 1 and screen 2, I'm going to move 32,000 bytes to those positions. So basically, I've created some screens and I stored them in some memory that I allocated. So 32,000 bytes is the whole screen. And then I'm going to use a bmove puts, which basically I do a bmove from this allocated screen to my logical screen, and then alternate both of them. So basically what I'm doing here is bmove in the way that I also would use the sput command. And as you can see, yeah, it works. And it seems to be working exactly the same, like sput. So that's kind of nice. There's actually one very important difference, and that is, I go back to my pre-draw to explain it. And where is my pre-draw? Here is my pre-draw. Because as you can see, I'm not just moving from my buffer screen. So normally here I would do an sget. And if I wanted to put the graphic somewhere with the sput command, I would actually have to switch to that screen first before I can put the data, because the sget and sput commands are graphics commands, and bmove is not, it's just a memory manipulator. So in this case, I can just choose my source and destination address any way I like. In this case, I'm doing from my buffer screen to screen 1, but if I this is my current write screen in the program when I'm doing the pre-draw, but if I, for instance, wanted to copy screen 1 to screen 2, I could just say screen 1 and screen 2 as source and destination without having to switch screens for my graphics commands. I have complete freedom, and that's a big difference. So that's quite interesting. And remember, in part 27, we actually used the sput command to create a sort of full screen animation. And that's the next example I want to show, because then we concluded sput is not fast enough to do the animation properly fast. So in this case, I converted the program to work with bmove instead of sget and sput, which basically means I'd still do the pre-draw, but instead of doing an sget and then sort of creating the stuff and do an sget and sput, now I create the canvas and copy that one over 20 times to a buffer that I created called cycle screen. So for my buffer screen to my cycle screen address, and for every step I'm going to add 32,000, I'm copying over the 20 backgrounds, sorry. And then after I did that, I actually used my plot ball procedure, but I switched to those screens and then do the drawing. So in each screen, I draw the balls until I'm finished. And then I'm going to do the animation. And I'm not going too deep in the code right now because we will get to the proper solution for this animation in a future video. But after the drawing of the balls, I'm going to do the loop screen. And instead of just doing a cycle where I do an sput of my screen, in this case, I'm just going to do a for next loop where I bmove from my source to my logical screen. And the effects, as we can see after this pre-drawing finishes, because it takes a little bit of time, the effect is very, very similar to the sput command. So yeah, the speed is about the same. It also suffers from the same limitations as the sput commands. It's still a bit jerky and we see some deformities in the screen, which means, remember in part 27, I told sput is not the solution to make these smooth full screen animations. And now we know that bmove is also not the solution for these full screen animations. But it was just an exercise to show that, yeah, we can do this. But we also see that bmove is actually just a little bit too slow to put the whole screen. It cannot put the whole screen within one vertical blank because the hardware of the ST is just not fast enough to do that. But for moving smaller parts of the screen in sequence, actually the bmove command is very suitable. And that means what we can do is we can make some really cool screen transitions because I've created some. In this case also, I create a few screens and first I'm going to do the bmove so that I can put them both in screens. And they are the same that I used in the previous two bits of code. But as you can see, I wrote some transitions and for instance, the easiest one is a slide transition. And basically every transition is I make sort of a for next loop. And in this case, in step of 80, because this is the simplest one. And in this case, I'm just going to copy only one scan line of data, so only 80 bytes. From my source, which is always defined by this this variable wipe screen. And in every step, I'm going to add 80 bytes to my wipe screen and my logical screen. So I'm going to copy it over scan line by scan line. So it's sort of a slide from top to bottom. And this wipe screen variable, as you can see, it's a variable that I have to pass to my procedure. So if you make a procedure and in between brackets you create this variable, it means it's a variable you have to pass to the procedure, which I'm now doing for the first time in my video series. And basically I say, I want my cover scroll transition here and I want you to use this address as the source address for this bmove command. And in this case, I'm manipulating it by adding this value, and this is the simplest slide one. You can also do it in other steps. So I created an interlaced one, for instance, where I do the even line first. So this command is exactly the same, except now I'm going from 0 to 31,920 in steps of 160 bytes. So I'm skipping a line. And then I'm doing the odd lines in the same way, but now I'm counting down. So it will sort of do an interlaced one. Yeah, and you can also do it upside down by putting them in reverse order. There's lots of stuff, and you can see this is the stuff in, if it depends on sort of a vertical movement of horizontal lines, then bmove is a very, very suitable command, because for that it's actually quite fast. Yeah, this one is the most interesting one, the cover scroll, because this also shows us the performance limitations of bmove. In this case, I'm going to wait for a vertical blank to make it a bit more smooth. And what I'm going to do is I'm first going to move the part of the new screen that I already put on my logical screen. So first this will be nothing, and then it will be like, I'm going to start at my logical screen plus 32,000, then 32,000 minus my step. And so the second step, it will take the bottom four scan lines of the screen and move them up a little bit. And then it will add the new scan lines in the bottom. So it's a bit difficult to explain the code while you are reading it. It's basically, I will show them first, sort of what the transitions do, and then I will give a tip on how to use the bmove command, because you can see that actually when using it, so this is the scroll transition, which basically shifts everything up 4 pixels. This is the slide transition. This is the upside down one. And this is the interlaced one. So yeah, they're pretty cool. You can see they are pretty fast. But as you can see, just reading these commands and then in your head comprehending what they actually do is actually quite difficult, because it's sort of, you have to take multiple steps, and this is just memory bytes and My advice for using bmove would be, and this command takes some planning ahead. So for each step in your process, first you have to determine what your result on screen actually should be. And the second step is actually think like the shifter. So think really like this is my start bytes, and if I move them, what happens here? So think like the shifter, sort of determine like I did in these visualizations. So you know what bytes you want to be where in memory for every step. And don't be afraid to draw it out on paper or like I did in Excel. Just use some colored cells in Excel to see your source and destination or start and end point for each steps. Because if you determine where you want every byte to be in memory by thinking like the shifter, then you can actually determine the correct sequence of bmove commands for each step. So yeah, you create these really simple transitions. And just to show the cover scroll, this shows this one is now fast and now it's gotten slow. And it got slow at about 60%, like 2/3 of the screen. And that's because of the limitation of the ST, the 68000 processor with a standard shifter. Because we have no dedicated graphics chip, the memory limitation is actually that the shifter can do about 20 kilobytes worth of memory of moving a screen within one vertical blank. And that's what you saw happening there. It did everything within one VBL. But at some point it got too slow, so suddenly it takes two VBLs instead of one. So it got twice. The speed went in half, basically. It was reduced to half. And that's very interesting to know. So yeah, for whole screen movement it's a bit too slow, but for transitions it's actually a pretty cool thing to use. As long as you make sure, especially that, don't move too much memory at once. And there's some more transitions. These are ones that I didn't write myself. But they are made by a guy named Carlos Tirado in 1990 for a cover disc for a magazine that I could find again. And these are getting a little bit more complicated, but they are actually quite cool. So I'm not going to explain all of them, but just to show that you can get some really cool effects with bmove for transitions. So this is it's a covering one, which is a bit slow because it has to move almost all screen data. But as you can see, this one we saw already. But this is my favorite, the roll down transition, which I did figure out after analyzing the code, but it's really difficult to explain it again. So I would say I will also publish this one if Carlos doesn't mind. And if he does, he should let me know in some way. But you can sort of look at the code, figure out. But remember, determine what result on screen you want to have. Think like the shifter, so you can determine what bytes you want to be where in memory. And don't be afraid to draw it out on paper. And then determine the correct sequence of bmove commands for each step. That's really the most important thing about this command. And the last thing I want to show is we can use it to move stuff on screen. Maybe we can also use it for some vertical scrolling. And I did some test code. And by now we already know that actually it's just a bit too slow to do the whole screen. So the scroll will not be very fast or smooth, but I just felt like doing it. And basically, it's going to do a pre-draw, which basically means, I'm making a Canva screen, which is sort of at the end, the last 32,000 bytes. And I'm going to do my buffer screen. So the standard background that I keep drawing, I put it there. And then I draw the circles again, going to bmove that whole screen to the scroll screen. And then I'm going to do a 6400 bytes and add that to the screen. So basically I'm creating a screen that is 480 pixels high. So I can sort of grab from position 0 to position to pixel 80. And then grab 32,000 bytes and put that where my screen is. So it looks like the screen is scrolling upwards. And that's what I'm doing here. So I'm taking steps, 2 pixel steps, because anything bigger than 2 pixels is not going to look very great. And I'm also doing a scroll where I only scroll part of the screen. I will just show, because I will publish the code, remember. So this is the 2 pixel scroll using bmove. So this is sort of okay. Unfortunately, it's also eating almost all my resources. So there's not much else I can do. Because if I want to do so much, now it takes 2 vertical blanks for every step, I think, or even 3. If I want to do more, it will get even slower. And the only thing you can do is maybe a 1 pixel scroll, but for 2 pixels, it will already become too jerky. Then I'm going to scroll the screen away because now I'm doing the same scroll routine. But instead of 400 lines, I'm doing 180 lines. And you can see that one is actually faster because now it doesn't have to wait so long. And it's also quite smooth. So this really shows if you keep it below 20K, it can do it actually pretty fast. And that's why it's so suitable for the transitions. And it's also suitable for some other stuff if the number of scan lines isn't too high, which we will see in a future video. Yeah, and just because I like these transitions so much, I added them in, because these are my favorite two ones. And just to show you, and now I'm scrolling like 2 pixels at a time. If I try to do a 4-pixel scroller, you can see that it's actually getting, this is getting jerky. This doesn't look good anymore. So this already makes it, yeah. So for 2-pixel scrolling, you can do it, but I wouldn't advise to use B-move for scrolling. Unless you do some extra other tricks, which we will come to also in a future video. But that's basically, yeah, the stuff I wanted to show in explaining the B-move commands. So we learned a lot of stuff, and it's handy to move data around and great for some cool transitions. It's also a bit slow for moving bytes on the screen. So for moving the whole screen, there are other tricks which we come to in the future video. And just to emphasize my advice on how to use the B-move command, remember, determine what your result on screen should be, and then think like the shifter. Really think like the shifter, and then determine what bytes you want to be where in memory, and draw it out on paper or use Excel or whatever, because it will really help you. And if you've done that, then you can determine the correct sequence of B-move commands for each step. And that's basically all I have to say about B-move. I want to thank you for watching this video. And I hope to see you next time when we go back to our sprite routine and do some optimizations there. I hope to see you then.